Well, it's great to have all of you here. My name is Pablo Villablanca. I'm one of the neuroradiologists at UCLA. And I understand we're going to be chatting a little bit about this topic. Now, how many of you have or have had at some point one of these problems, back, hip, arm, or leg pain? Yeah, it's pretty common. Say about 80% of people at some point in their lives will get one of these symptoms. And what we're going to talk about today is some of the common causes of these symptoms and how we manage them, how I and my colleagues at UCLA who work in the pain clinic with me evaluate patients who have complaints related to these areas. So we're going to talk a little bit about the service. Then we're going to cover a little bit of anatomy. It's always good to know a little bit of anatomy and how it relates to our bodies and our symptoms. We're going to talk more specifically about the nerves, the spinal nerves that come all the way from the brain down to the spinal cord and then out to individual parts of our body. And every nerve has its own little territory, covers just one little area, both muscle and skin. And that's where our symptoms come from, and that's what we need to know as pain radiologists to figure out where the symptoms might be coming from and then what we need to do about it. We're going to talk about a little bit about nerve imaging and then the treatment of nerve pain. So the spine service at UCLA provides both diagnostic, meaning imaging and clinical diagnosis, and pain management interventions for those people that require it. Not everybody requires it. Most people do just fine with a little physical therapy and maybe some medication and some exercise. But sometimes you've got to go a little bit farther, and we'll talk a little bit about some of those techniques. We also engage the community in educational programs like the one that we're doing this afternoon. And then we're doing research to try and push the field a little bit farther and see if maybe we can't figure out better ways to do things or more efficient ways to help our patients or come up with longer lasting treatments. And then we also apply to the government and foundations for funds to do our work, to do our research, and to do the kind of work that we think is necessary to help our patients more. So these are the members of the Interventional Spine Service at UCLA. You can see we've got nurse practitioners and schedulers, special sedation nurses, technologists that help us run the machines, and then the doctors that see the patients in the clinic and will talk to you and evaluate you and go over your symptoms as well as do the physical exam and come up with what's called an assessment and plan, or A&P. That's the most important part of what we do, and really that's the key to, I think, a good treatment. That means taking the time to sit down, meet each of you personally, talk to you about specifically what your symptoms are, how long you've had them, where you've got them, when they manifest themselves. Is it when you bend over or when you're reaching back? Is it when you're up like this or down over here? All those things are little clues that help us to understand where the symptoms might be coming from. The other is the quality of the pain. Is it sharp? Is it dull? Is it achy? Is it stabby? Is it electrical? That's another little clue. Do you have any sensory symptoms? In other words, is there a place on your skin where the skin doesn't feel normal? Maybe it's dull or too sharp. Any little touch bothers your skin. Those are all very important things, as well as weakness or numbness. And then in part of the physical exam, we'll also check reflexes, and those are important for telling us how well a nerve may or may not be working. But all these people work to bring the whole service together and help us to have it run smoothly. So what we do is make sure we get an accurate clinical history from you, how long you've had the symptoms, et cetera. Do a physical exam that's focused really on the nerves, the neurology of your body. And correlate then the clinical symptoms and signs to any imaging findings that we decide we might need to pursue. So let's have somebody who comes in and says, you know, Dr. Villablanca, for the last 6 months I've had a terrible pain from my back down my buttocks and out along the outside of my leg. And this started when I was hanging Christmas ornaments, and you know, and now I've got this terrible pain. And then I'll check their reflexes and I'll say, well, you know, based on the exam, I think you could have a herniated disc. And we'll talk a little bit later about what that is. And then we may get a scan to confirm that. And if the herniated disc is one that looks like it will recover on its own, then just a little medication, some physical therapy will do the job. But sometimes it's bigger and it's really pressing the nerve and causing a lot of irritation, a lot of pain, then we may actually need to put a little tiny skinny needle right next to the nerve and there deliver some medication that would help to soothe and quiet the nerve down while the body heals that injury and the disc material resorbs, shrinks down, and leaves the nerve alone. Sometimes the disc abnormality could be really big, almost too big for the body to manage on its own, and then it may be appropriate to consider removing some of that material so that the nerve does not get a permanent injury. So this is all sort of the evaluation that occurs when we see the patient in the clinic. So these are some of the things that I mentioned to you that we will try to elicit from each of you, each patient that we see in the clinic. And to do this, it takes a bit of time. But quite frankly, this is the most important part of the whole encounter. It's not the scan or the injection. Those are things that we may need to do to confirm the clinical impression. But the clinical diagnosis is the key, and that's where each patient is crucial in providing that information and making sure that we've got it right. Because if the pain is burning, it might be a different source than if the pain is dull or achy. So I want to know, is the pain achy? That makes me think about facets. Is the pain burning? That makes me think about nerves. So just the words that you use to describe your pain really help me to understand where it might be coming from. So these are all the qualities of the pain or other symptoms that we try to understand. And then by understanding each one of these, we're able to come up with what's called a differential diagnosis. I think that the most likely cause of your symptoms is A, or maybe B, or C. And then what do I plan to do to figure out which one of those it is? And then we'll look at what's happened in the past in terms of treatments and what the patient may have done, him or herself, to try and make the symptoms better. Have you been resting? Do you use heat, massage? Have you taken some Advil or Aleve? And have those things helped to either alleviate or maybe not alleviate your symptoms? So all these things are really, really important. And each one of them, it doesn't sound like much, but when you put them all together, they really help us to create a mental image with the knowledge that we have as physicians of what may be happening anatomically to explain the clinical symptoms that you're experiencing. So we always want to ensure good outcomes. And that means that whether we're doing a procedure or we're seeing you in the clinic, everything's got to be right. If we're going to do a procedure, we got to make sure the machine's turned on. We got to make sure the machine's working. All these basic things that sometimes get overlooked. These are just straightforward, simple things. And we want to make sure the patient has a good experience. For my clinic and my patients, I use, when they do require a procedure, I use very, very thin needles. They're so thin that most patients feel very little. And because of that, we don't have to give you any medication in the vein, just a little bit of local medication in the area where the procedure is done. And the good news about that is that the procedure is much faster for the patient. You're not groggy from medications that you've received in your vein in order to have what's essentially a minimally invasive procedure. So by using these very, very thin needles, it allows you to have a good experience with less discomfort during the procedure or frequently no discomfort. And then hopefully a better outcome or as good as it would be with a bigger needle and a shorter time hanging around in the hospital waiting to actually have the procedure or waiting to recover from conscious sedation if it had been given in the vein versus not having the conscious sedation at all. So let's talk a little bit about the anatomy. Most of the symptoms that we experience in our arms, legs, and buttocks are actually coming from the spine. And the reason that that's the case is that the nerves that go to the muscles and the skin in our legs, arms, and buttocks are arising from the spine. And in the spine, it's a complicated place, and there's a lot of things that can go wrong there, little issues. For most of us, it's actually sort of just wear and tear. arthritis, little bony spurs that build up, and then those little bony spurs can pinch nerves. And you can see that here, this is the front of the person, this is the back, and then there's this open space, this triangular space in the middle. That triangular space is called the spinal canal. And all these vertebrae, here you're looking at one from above, but they're all sort of stacked up, one on top of the other. You might have seen it in a chicken spine or something. And they're all stacked up, and this essentially forms a tube, a hollow tube, where up high in the neck and in the chest, the spinal cord resides, and the spinal cord ends at about where my fingers are, and then it continues down as just nerves. Those nerves are called the cauda equina. And those nerves are the ones that go to the pelvis and to the legs. So frequently, when there are symptoms in a patient, it may be because a bony spur has developed here or here that's pinching a nerve, or sometimes pinching all the nerves. When all the nerves are pinched in the lumbar spine in the lower area, that's called spinal stenosis, and spinal stenosis can occur most frequently in that lumbar area. And when it occurs, there's very little room for the nerves, and they can get crowded. And when they get crowded, you can get around, but not with much comfort. You walk a few feet, then your feet feel heavy, your legs feel achy and painful, you've got to stop and rest. Those are the kinds of symptoms I'd be trying to elicit if I thought somebody might have spinal stenosis. So here's a view of the cervical spine, in this case, the neck, right? Cervical neck. And this is a view from the side, and this is the front of the patient, this is the back. And you can see every one of these little bones has a name, every little part has a name, and the vertebra, the bones, are in yellow, and then these little greenish bands are the discs. The discs are cushion material that exists between each vertebra to kind of cushion one bone against the other and to allow for movement or mobility. So one vertebra is stacked one on top of the other, and then these discs are relatively mobile. All of this is held together with ligaments and other soft tissues so that things don't crumble down. And they also can have problems. Sometimes the ligaments get a little bit worn or they can get inflamed, and that can be quite painful. So our job as interventional radiologists is to figure out, based on talking to the patient, where the symptoms are most likely to be arising from, confirm that hypothesis with an imaging study and say, I was suspicious that the nerve that comes out of this opening right here was being pinched. And sure enough, on the scan, you can see a little bony spur or a little disc herniation or some other problem that's pinching that nerve. And then we evaluate the severity of the symptoms with the magnitude of the problem on the scan and come up with a treatment plan. So it's all very evidence-driven. There's not a lot of guesswork. I don't think that, you know, patient and patient procedures are a time for guessing. We need information. We need good information. And the way to get it is from talking to you, the patient, doing the physical exam, and then when necessary, doing the imaging study. Here are some of the ligaments. In this case, it's the lumbar spine. These are the same bones that you saw up in the neck. These are the vertebra. In this case, the lumbar vertebra. There's the spinal canal. And you can see these white bands. These are all ligaments. And all these ligaments play an important role in keeping everything together. But as time goes on, or sometimes through injury, these ligaments themselves can become frayed, worn, or in some cases torn. And when they are torn, that means that the spine is not quite as strong as it was, or it's more vulnerable to injury. So those are the things that we would look for as well, particularly if a patient told us that they had fallen. So we've seen the bones. Here's in the lumbar area again. Here now they're depicted in white. There's the spinal canal going top to bottom. This is the back of the patient. These are little bones that come back. Sometimes you can feel those little bones on, if you touch your back yourself. These are the spinous processes. And each vertebra is like a ring. It has the hollow part inside that allows for the passage of the nerves. And then it has in the back some bony plates and a little bony spine in the back. Posterior spinous process. The vertebra, these red areas here are the disc spaces in this diagram shown in red. And then you can see in yellow, those are the nerves. Those are the nerves coming out of the spinal canal. And they exit through openings that are called foramina. So anything that's a foramen is an opening. It can be a foramen in a, you have a foramen in this brick wall. This is a foramen in the bony spinal canal. And inside, through these openings, natural gaps in the bone, you can see more yellow material, which is all the other nerve roots that are not exiting at this level, but rather going down to the levels below. So the spinal cord ends at about where the letters are, and then you have a whole host of nerves, and at each level, a set of nerve emerges to the right and to the left, going to the specific body part that that nerve innervates. And each one of these nerves has a very, very reliable, very reproducible territory, both for muscle and for skin, in all of us. So, for instance, in the lumbar spine, there are five lumbar nerves. L1 is in the groin. L2 is in the inner thigh. L3 is in the distal inner thigh. L4 is the front of the thigh to the knee and going down to the medial shin. L5 is now buttocks wrapping around to the outside of the thigh, the outside of the calf, heel, and lateral foot. And S1, which is another little nerve coming down, goes down along the back of the thigh and calf. So by talking to the patients and saying, well, where's your pain? Well, you know, my pain is along here, and so on and so forth. Already, we're getting an idea of the nerves that may be the troublemakers. And then we can begin to think about where the source of the problem might be. Now, nerves are very interesting structures. They are basically like this cord here. They have insulation on the outside, and the conducting part, where electrical activity goes from one nerve cell to another, is in the center. And each one of these little elements, the tiny little axons, which are the smallest little conducting fibers that go from one individual nerve cell to another, is insulated. Then they are grouped into individual little cables, which themselves are insulated, and then a bunch of cables are grouped together into a larger structure to form a bigger nerve. Each one of these little fascicles is pretty tough, pretty tough. They can take a little stretching, they can take a little bending, they can even take a little squishing, but they can't take too much of it. And what happens is that if you squish the nerve too much, then what ends up happening is that some of the insulation gets frayed. And when you have frayed insulation on a cable, it's a place where the electrical activity will not be conducted normally. It's almost like a short circuit. So the electricity comes down the cable, it hits the bare spot and goes, whoops, I need to do a little loop there. And every time it does a loop, it sends a little signal back up to your brain saying, something's wrong. Something's wrong in this nerve, and that is something we usually perceive as pain or an uncomfortable sensation, either burning or achiness or stabbing pain. And many of us, of course, have felt those symptoms, unfortunately. So here we can see a nerve, and if that nerve is compressed very, very gradually over decades, it's remarkable the amount of squishing that a nerve will take and still, you know, keep on ticking. But if that compression happens rather quickly, then the symptoms can come on very rapidly because the nerve hasn't had a chance to adapt. So for those of us that have narrowed foramina or other compressed nerves because of bony spurs that have grown very slowly from the bone over decades, most of us don't actually have symptoms, even though we have lots of those spurs. I don't treat patients because they have spurs on their skin. I only treat a patient because of the symptoms that those spurs might cause. If there are no symptoms, there's no reason to do anything about them. Let the spurs live. This diagram is a picture of a person from the front and the back. And you can see that they look like they're wearing a suit. And that suit is filled with mostly horizontal stripes in the legs, some vertical stripes. These are the dermatomes I was telling you about a moment ago. So you can see that everybody's body, every single person, has these dermatomes. They might vary a little bit from person to person, but by and large, they're all very consistent. So again, if somebody says, you know, Dr. Villablanca, I've got this terrible pain down the back of my calf, my thigh, calf, all the way down to the bottom of my foot, I'd say, well, that corresponds to the S1 dermatome. S1. So already I'm suspicious that that nerve somewhere along its path is having something irritated. And if I can't figure out what it is just based on the exam, we might do a scan to try and investigate that and see what's going on. Right here, you see this little number right there, S1.
Oh,
See? And so S1 is actually like a strip, like a piece of cloth that you've draped on your body that tells you what skin territory that nerve is responsible for. Now, these are the dermatomes, which is derm is skin, like dermatologists. These are the dermatomes. There are also myotomes, because each one of these nerves has two jobs. One is sensation and providing information back up to the brain about what it's feeling out there, and the other is movement. There's a bunch of muscles, right? You've got your calf muscles, your thigh muscles, and every one of these nerves also has some of those jobs. They innervate specific muscles. So when I interview a patient and I examine a patient, I'm looking for dermatomal problems as well as myotomal problems. And if the dermatome and myotome match, I say, hey, it's the S1. It's the S1 nerve that's the problem. And then we're already on our way to figuring out the cause. And once you know the cause, you've got options in terms of what you're going to do for treatment. Any questions so far? It's an overview, just to kind of give you a rough idea of what we're doing. Now, the neck has a bunch of dermatomes, just like all parts of the body. This is a picture of a woman looking from the back, and these numbers, letters and numbers, represent individual cervical nerves that are coming out of the spinal cord through these bony openings to provide sensation to certain parts of the skin in the neck. So if somebody says, you know, I always have terrible pain right in here, right here, right in this area, I'm thinking, aha, this is a C5-6 foramen. Coming out of that is a C6 nerve. So I'm suspicious that there could be something irritating this patient's left C6 nerve. And then I might get a scan, either a CT or an MRI, to look for narrowing of the foramen where that nerve comes out. Is it narrowed by a herniated disc? Is it narrowed by a bony spur? All those things tell me what we might need to do to get those symptoms to go away if conservative management, meaning physical therapy, rest, massage, a soft collar, and some medications haven't done the job. Now, this gives you an idea of how complicated things are. This is just a little diagram of the arteries and veins and the nerves and how they pass through various areas and where they can get pinched and kinked and so on and so forth. This is not your job to worry about. It's our job to worry about. So we need to learn about all this in medical school. Then as you get additional training in your specialty and subspecialty, this really becomes second nature, so that when you meet somebody, you examine them, already your mind is automatically thinking about every one of these stations where things can happen and where people can get into trouble and where their nerves can experience unhappiness. So there are lots of different types of pain. And pain has been divided into syndromes, which are sort of a collection of symptoms that help to define the most likely cause of that pain. So for instance, people who have discogenic pain typically will have pain in the most common place is the lumbar spine, the lower lumbar area here, that occurs when they move in a specific position, or that arose suddenly after a activity, lifting a heavy box, moving a heavy object, so that the amount of force that they exerted exceeded the strength of these structural parts of their body, and some part of that spinal area was damaged. And the weakest spot is these discs. We'll talk a little bit more about them and why they tend to be kind of an Achilles heel. Then we'll talk about discogenic pain, I should also mention, is also something that causes a pain that typically shoots down the leg, right? Because it's pinching a nerve, typically, and that nerve provides, as we mentioned, innervation, both sensory and motor, to the leg. Degenerative pain, on the other hand, tends to be more local. It's like, you know, I've got pain right here. That is an area that's pretty common, because we have some little joints in our lower back, in fact, all along our back, but the most commonly are diseased ones in the lower lumbar spine. They're like little miniature knee joints that you have back here. And what they do is they allow for movement, and they also allow for flexibility because they're locked one on the other. But what happens is sometimes with wear and tear, with age, and sometimes through injury, they will become injured. And when they become injured, they become inflamed. And whenever anything becomes inflamed, it's like a bursitis or an arthritic joint in your finger, it swells, gets red, and can be quite painful. So for that, we can offer the possibility of some medication right into the inflamed joint. If it's a disc that's causing an impingement on a nerve, we can put medication right next to the nerve, or a little bit more generally into the spinal canal in the vicinity of the nerve to kind of quiet and soothe everything. Some patients have had an injury to the bone. The nerve is fine, it's just that the vertebra cracked. And when the vertebra cracks, it can be extremely painful. And the reason for that is that on the outside of the bone, we have lots and lots of nerve endings. Inside, there's nothing. There's just some bone marrow and little bone spicules. But on the outside, lots of nerve endings. And those nerve endings fire signals back up to our brain whenever the vertebra is deformed. So a vertebra that's perfectly square, bone in our spine, that's perfectly normal, no movement, right? No symptoms. But a vertebra that's cracked, every time we bend or twist, we'll bend ever so slightly, and that can send big pain signals up to the brain and cause tremendous havoc. And typically, these will heal on their own. When they're not healing, then what happens is that we need to help that body to be more stiff, and that's done by putting a little bit of cement, a sterile bone cement, into the bone. Not necessarily to make it as tall as it used to be, but just to keep it from bending around. And that usually takes care of the pain. That procedure is called a vertebroplasty. And then sometimes people have pain that's arising from something that's growing in the vertebra that doesn't belong there. Some malignant tissue, they might have a history of breast cancer or prostate cancer, and then some of these bad cells have gone into the spine, where they can weaken the vertebra and create symptoms. So what we'll do is, as necessary, we'll obtain a little bit of that tissue through minimally invasive tools, just a little tiny device that we use to just get a little bit of bone out, confirm what the nature of that tissue is, test it for response to treatment, chemotherapy, radiation, whatever it is that is appropriate, make sure that we have the right tools selected, and then treat that patient either systemically with a medication to get rid of those malignant cells in their whole body, or if they just have the cancer in a couple of places, kill it, either by freezing it, which is called cryoablation, or by cooking the tumor, by putting a little device right into where those tumor cells are, heating it up and burning that tumor, and it's gone. And that can be very effective also in getting rid of the pain that sometimes comes from these conditions. So let's talk a little bit about this epidural steroid injection. This is typically done for somebody who has a herniation. And here you can see a diagram, sort of a sketch of a herniation. So think about the disc material as a cushion that you might have on a seat. It's got some height. And around the outside of this cushion is a belt. The belt is strong. And that keeps the stuffing in the cushion inside. That's much like our lumbar, cervical, and thoracic discs are. They're like jelly material in the inside, and then that jelly, that cushioning jelly, is kept in place by these fibers that are called Sharpie's fibers, that are like a belt that keep everything in there. But sometimes, because of wear and tear or injury, those Sharpie's fibers will be torn, partially or completely. So it's like having a tear in my belt. Now, everything that is being held in by the belt is no longer held in, and that is an area where some of this jelly material can come out. Now, when that happens, you can see what's right next to it. Remember last time I showed you that yellow structure? That's a nerve. So this is a view looking from underneath at somebody's spinal canal. There are all the little nerve roots floating around. Here are two nerve roots that happen to be coming out, one in each direction. And then here's this little outpouching of the disc material that's in a position to pinch the nerve. If that nerve is pinched very quickly, then that nerve will certainly let you know that it's unhappy by sending pain that's sometimes quite severe down along the dermatome that it innervates, much like in the diagram of that person with all those lines and numbers on it. That's the dermatome. If this was L4, that individual will have pain along their back, upper buttocks, anterolateral thigh, usually down to the knee. So that's an L4 dermatome. So if we see that there is a herniation here, based on the scan, and the symptoms are just not responding to Advil, Aleve, maybe a little touch of steroids by mouth, rest and physical therapy, and maybe a lumbar support brace, then we might need to add a little bit of steroid into the spinal canal right next to where the nerve is. And that is a very straightforward procedure. The patient's on their tummy, clean off the back, numb it up on the surface and deep, and then put a tiny little skinny needle right into the spinal canal through these natural openings in the back of the spine. That's done either with fluoroscopy, which are little low-level x-rays that allow us to see the bony anatomy right through the skin, or with CAT scan that allows us to see the same thing, essentially. And once I've confirmed that this needle tip is in the right spot, I don't want it in the canal, in the sac where all the other nerve roots are. I want it out here between the bone and the sac. I put a tiny little bit of dye, confirm that it's in the right place, and then through that needle, which is hollow, I put in some anesthetic and some long-acting steroids. And that can help for weeks or months to decrease the symptoms. It doesn't get rid of the herniation. The herniation is still there. But your body is working on the herniation because all this material, all this jelly material, we've never seen it. If we've never had a herniated disc, we've never seen that jelly material. So the minute that jelly material comes out, your immune system goes, whoa, what is that stuff? That does not belong in my body. And there are a bunch of cells in your body whose only job it is to go around gobbling up strange things. And it says, huh, that material, I've never seen that stuff, I gotta get rid of it. And all the cells and macrophages go in there and start gobbling it up. The challenge is that you can imagine the size of a cell, right? I mean, tiny little microscopic little guy, and then you've got this herniated disc that can take weeks or months to occur. So between the process of dehydration or drying up of the disc, which tends to shrink it, plus your own body gobbling up that foreign material, that usually is enough over time to take care of the problem. I mentioned that in some cases, it's not enough, or even more material keeps coming out. And in those cases, you actually may need to go in and remove it surgically so that it stops putting pressure on the nerve and keeps the nerve from getting permanent injury. Typically, pain, numbness, and even a little bit of transient weakness are okay. But progressive numbness or progressive weakness or loss of muscle mass is not okay. So if you have any of those symptoms, you definitely have to get into your doctor because that may indicate that you've got a condition that if you don't act on it quick, you may have irreversible nerve injury, right? So all of my patients that we treat conservatively, which is most of them, get treated conservatively initially because they do have just pain or some bit of numbness rarely a little touch of weakness. But I tell them if at any point your numbness gets progressive, meaning more and more numb, or you develop any weakness so that it's hard to move the leg, either stand up, sit down, lift, whatever, I want you to let me know right away because that means that we need to check it out, see if the disc has gotten bigger, and if it has and it's pressing more on the nerve, it may be time to take that disc material away so that permanent nerve injury doesn't occur. So here's another diagram showing the vertebra. This is the front of the patient, this is the back. This is the bone and the bony architecture inside. This white thing is the disc material. This is a sac that holds in the fluid that bathes the spinal cord and the nerves. And here's a little needle that's come in from the back. It's parked just in the right place between the bone and the sac, and then it's getting ready to deliver the medication that will provide relief to the nerve by decreasing the amount of inflammation. And then here are two images from an x-ray, two x-ray images that were taken during such a procedure. This is an epidural steroid injection where the medication is going into the epidural space. This is a view from the back of the patient. These are the vertebra. This band is a disc. Here's another disc. These whitish areas are natural openings in the back of the spine that I use and my colleagues use to gain access to the spinal canal. And then this little kind of curvilinear black thing is a catheter connected to a needle. Here's the needle coming in from the side view. This is the front of the patient, this is the back. And the needle's been placed right into that epidural space. And first you confirm that the needle's in the right location with a little bit of contrast material, just a little bit of dye that comes out in your urine after an hour or two. And then once we confirm it's in the proper location, then at that point you administer both the anesthetic and the steroid to give relief. Any questions on this procedure? Yes.
If one does not tolerate steroids orally, does that follow for this injection?
There are a number of reasons that people might not tolerate steroids. Some people have, if they take it orally, they have stomach irritation. That would not happen if the medication was given via this route. Other people, what happens to you?
Bleeding.
Oh, bleeding from? Okay, yeah, so we would deal with each one of those circumstances separately. Most people tolerate steroids just fine. Some people find that after the medication, they're just a little bit more irritable, maybe a little for just a day or two. Maybe they feel more hungry than usual for a day or two, or they might feel a little bit more energetic for a couple of days. And then after a few days, that tends to go away and you're just left with hopefully the benefits. But some people rarely will not be able to tolerate the steroids, and we have other things that we can use.
Is the procedure done on an outpatient basis?
Yes. Yeah. All of these procedures that I'll show you today, they're all outpatient. This procedure takes 10 to 15 minutes to do, and you come in and you're out the door. The one thing that I ask for anybody who's had an epidural is that you go home and rest, because sometimes the medication in the epidural space can make the legs just a little wobbly, and I don't want anybody to fall. So when the procedure's done, you go home and you kick back. You read your favorite book, you watch TV, and you rest until the next day.
Final question.
Yeah.
The X-ray, is CT to be a CAT scan preferable to MRI, or does it matter?
We typically don't do these procedures with MRI, because MRI takes a very long time to get the images, and generally with MRI you can't have metal materials around the MRI, so this procedure is little needles and so on. So we typically do it with fluoroscopy, which is this low-level X-ray, or with CAT scan, which is also low-level X-rays. Yes?
Yes, I used to get injections of cortisone, and they don't call it cortisone anymore, they call it something else I never can remember. Is that the same as this?
Yes, that's right.
It
is a steroid. There are a number of different steroids that can be used. Some people will use one type or another. I vary the type of steroid I use depending on the location in the body that I'm working in. But I tend to prefer ones that require just a little volume and that last a long time. So the one that I use is betamethasone or celestone. That's the one I most frequently use. No, but there's solimedrol, there's solicortef, there's a whole bunch of them. Yes.
Is this injection shrink the herniation disc?
Not really. Time shrinks the herniation. Your body shrinks the herniation. Because most of these discs are mostly water. And so, you know, things that have water tend to dry up over time. So these guys tend to dry up. And they do tend to shrink back and go back to where they came from.
By itself?
By itself.
The herniation disc shrink by itself?
Yes. Yeah. Plus time. Your body will, as we mentioned a moment ago, your body will recognize it as foreign and gobble it up.
Wow, how could it happen?
Because bodies are miraculous things. So my job is just to make things, to buy time, basically. This procedure buys time.
So this injection only you have less pain, doesn't do anything
correct
to the patient?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Not really, no.
So it doesn't shrink it, still the nerve, it's not happy because it's pushing it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have
actually,
a situation, that's why
yeah, no, the nerve, you'd be surprised. The nerve is still being squished, but because the steroids are there, it's decreasing the irritability of the nerve and swelling of the nerve, because when a nerve gets squished, it swells. And so what this does is it decreases the swelling, and sometimes all you need is a little bit less swelling, and suddenly it's not touching the disc anymore.
Oh, it's just release the swelling of the nerve.
Yeah.
It doesn't shrink the herniation.
No. So that's why I said this treatment doesn't cure the herniation, but it does buy valuable time that may keep you out of the operating room so that the herniation heals both by time through dehydration, shrinking through dehydration, drying up and shriveling up, and also through your body recognizing as foreign and gobbling it up. Both of those things are happening from the minute the herniation occurs. Yes.
How often do you have to repeat this?
Sometimes one is all that's necessary. Sometimes people have such a big herniation that I can tell just after the very first one that it's not going to help them, and so we'll just do one. And then maybe they'll need to go right away.
Okay.
to have it removed.
Is it supposed to be painful? Because
no.
Generally speaking, after she puts a needle in,
yeah,
it's nothing is done. But then yeah, a couple of times when I have an injection, yeah, cortisone, whatever that was called, substitute for that,
yeah,
it was painful for a while.
Yeah, it shouldn't hurt at all.
And it didn't last as much as you're saying.
Yeah. If it's properly done, it shouldn't hurt at all. Now, the duration varies depending on the severity of the problem. So if you have a really big herniation, Dr. Villablanca can put a little steroid in there, but I do not walk on water, and it's unlikely that all the pain will go away. So sometimes what we do is, it's like being in the ring with a boxer, right? You're boxing away, you give them a whack, and they're a little bit dazed, but they're not down. You got to give them another whack, and then they go down. So these steroid injections can be like that. You give one to kind of bring things down, and then quickly you give another one, and then you really get a good amount of relief.
How long is it supposed to last?
Weeks to months.
No, never happened.
So without knowing your specific condition, I couldn't explain why that occurred.
I have one more question.
Yes.
If the radiation is shrink by itself, why do you have surgically remove it?
I said earlier, if you have progressive numbness, okay, progressive weakness, or pain that does not respond to an epidural steroid injection, meaning pain that is completely out of control, and no matter what we do, we cannot bring that pain under a manageable level, then that dearth material may need to come out.
So
that would be the only indication.
But if you can manage the pain,
yeah,
with the
yeah,
medication,
yes,
even the herniation is very big,
yes,
isn't that dangerous for the nerve?
No. So what I do is I monitor the patient. So if the patient says, I've got a little numbness, Dr. Villablanca, but after the epidural steroid injection, it hasn't gotten any worse, maybe it's a little bit better, and I have no weakness, you are right on to continue conservative management. So the only time to intervene is when you have progressive symptoms, and you think that those symptoms are indicative of the possibility of permanent nerve injury, which we don't want, right? You can have transient temporary nerve irritation, but you don't want permanent nerve injury. So those are the things that we look for. A leg that's shrinking, right, because the muscle is losing its nerve supply. A pain that is completely not responsive. Or numbness that's getting worse and worse. Or weakness that is developing and progressing. Those are the only indications for surgery. Yeah. Anybody else? There was one other.
Lately, I have a knee pain.
Yes.
And it was patella condromalacia.
Yes.
The physical therapy is not helping so far. Mm-hmm. So from the lecture I heard today, you think it's possible from L4, 5, S1 problem?
That's a great question. If it's isolated knee pain, isolated meaning yeah, only in the knee, no. If it's radiating pain to the knee, yes. So it sounds like it's just isolated knee. So it's probably not related to the spine.
Because
it's probably
from your lecture, mm-hmm, you said if you have a knee pain,
if it goes to the knee, so from the back to the thigh to the knee, that, yeah, but if it's just isolated only in the knee, it's probably arthritis of the knee.
So you're not the right person to see that?
No, but one of my colleagues could see you. We have a musculoskeletal colleague. I'm the neuroradiologist, so anything having to do with nerves, spine, brain, that would be my role. And for the elbows, shoulders, our musculoskeletal colleagues do those. No, they are a radiologist, but they're a musculoskeletal radiologist. That person deals just with like elbows, wrists, and knees. All right. Now, the medication can either go into the back of the canal, like in that diagram that I showed you here, or sometimes we'll put the medication into the epidural space through one of the bony openings, the foramen here. So here the needle is coming in, delivering the medication perhaps closer to where a disc herniation might be. And we will put this medication wherever we think that it will do the best good. That's the transforaminal approach in this case. And wherever we think that it will give the patient the longest duration of relief. Medication can also be put into the neck, into the epidural space. And here's an x-ray of the cervical spine showing this blackish material, which is just a little bit of dye material that's being administered through the needle to confirm that the needle's in the proper location before administering the steroid and anesthetic. And then if it's determined that the medication belongs not so much in the spinal canal, but actually just beyond that, in the foramen where the nerve comes out, because the nerve is being pinched there by a herniated disc or by a bony spur, then the medication is administered not into the canal here in the center, but actually out towards the side. And these little black stripes represent a little bit of dye material that's been injected through the needle tip, these black things are the little needles, to confirm that they are in the proper location before administering the anesthetic and the steroid. And these can be very, very effective. I've got one gentleman who's a jeweler. He comes once a year for his cervical nerve block. Here's an image, again, from a x-ray machine for a patient that's having nerve pain in the C7 nerve on the left side. And these blocks here are the vertebra. These white stripes are the disc space. The patient's chin is up here to the left. The back of the head is over here on the right. And these oval areas are the foramina, the bony openings where the nerves comes out. And you can see that this one's nice and big. This one's nice and big. Whoops, this one, it gets narrowed. And see those little spurs there? Those are bony spurs that are pinching the nerve. And those develop because of arthritis. Now, interestingly enough, the cushion between the vertebra is the disc, right? We talked about that jelly material. As that jelly material degenerates, the only thing that the body knows how to do to kind of manage that degenerative process is to make more bone. So if you've got a vertebra that's supposed to be shaped like a block, as that cushioning material disappears, now you have bone on bone. And the body says, ooh, that's not good. I don't want bone on bone. So let's kind of spread the area over which that stress is distributed. Let's make more bone. And so what these are bony spurs that are rising from the vertebra trying to spread out the stress. Now, it's not a horrible idea, except that there's not a lot of room for bony spurs in the spine. And if they go back or they go back and to the side, they can impact these foramina and pinch the nerves. And that can be a problem. Again, here, some bit of contrast material being administered, confirm that the needle's in the right place before the medication is administered. And for all these, there are specific amounts of these medications that are administered. Some places, they like to put their patients to sleep when they do the procedure. Part of it is that the procedure is done with a bigger needle, so it's more painful. In our group, we use needles that are very, very slender, and there's very little discomfort, and we also want the patients talking to us, so that if there's any issue at all, yeah, patient's telling me, hey, Dr. Villablanca, there's a problem. And the knock on wood, after thousands of procedures, we've never had a complication, but that's one of the reasons. We listen to our patients and what our patients are telling us. Yes?
Can you clean off those spurs?
With a surgery. Can you clean off the spurs is the question. So yes, the spurs can be removed when absolutely necessary, but that would require a surgical procedure. So that one of my neurosurgical colleagues makes a small incision in the neck, goes down to where the spurs are, and has a small little drill or other tool that they use to remove them.
Well, then the body will need more spurs.
Yeah, it takes years though. Like these spurs that you're seeing in this scan over here, those spurs right there probably took 20 years to make. Yeah. You had a question, ma'am.
So, like what you say, if you feel the pain and will ask you to do something, they won't have a spur coming out.
That's right. The procedures will not cause spurs to develop.
Wait until you're so painful. It should be just minor painful.
If it's a little bit of pain,
then won't have a spur happen.
Okay, so I think I understand your question. The question is, if you have minor pain, is that the time to look into the problem versus if you have really advanced pain? Because if you have advanced pain, that may mean that enough time has passed that these spurs will develop. The sooner you see a pain specialist for pain, usually the better it is. That's not because the procedure is planned. Most of my patients have no procedures. But it allows me to identify the things that may be causing the problem to occur. Maybe it's a particular way you do a hobby or a particular activity, the way you work on the computer. There are so many things that can be optimized to make things better and to minimize the possibility of facilitating the development of arthritic changes. Those are things that are really good to know about. And if you come to see one of us, we'll educate you about those things. So you go, gosh, I never realized that it wasn't so good for me to be doing that. If only I had known. Well, once you know, then you can prevent, potentially, the formation of these spurs. Sometimes, in spite of our best efforts, they will still form. And usually, the patients that tend to get these, no matter what you do, are patients who have a very strong family history of arthritis. They're just a family that makes bony spurs. But for most of us, that's not the case.
What are spurs?
Bony spurs are those little bony overgrowths that we were talking about, where the body tries to spread out the stress. Because the discs have degenerated, those jelly spacers have collapsed, and now it's bone on bone. And the body's saying, you know, I need to spread out that stress by making these little bony areas, trying to increase the area of interaction between one bone and another. Well, that increased area is a spur, essentially.
So there's no cartilage, like in the knee. My sister has bone to bone.
I bet you she has pain.
She's swimming every day.
That's fantastic.
She's raising her legs.
That's fantastic.
And her pain is gone.
Which it really brings up an excellent point. Exercise is our friend, and I'm talking gentle exercise. I'm talking about getting over there and lifting weights. I'm talking about walking, swimming, anything that's really non-weight-bearing, and base isometric exercises or just gravity-type exercise. Those are all wonderful because a lubricated joint is a happy joint, and a lubricated joint is a joint that's being used. Also, every muscle supports the skeleton. If the muscles are weak and deconditioned, the skeleton doesn't have much support. So you want to make sure that your muscles are toned. That doesn't mean you're going to go lifting weights. You don't need big muscles. You just need toned muscles. And those toned muscles are ones that have, every day they're doing a little something. They're walking, they're swimming, they're spinning on a bicycle. You've got little tiny little, you know, cans of soup that you're doing this with and this with. If it doesn't hurt you when you're doing it, it's probably okay, and especially if it's just a little bit of weight that you're using or no weight at all. Just this alone is tremendously good for your shoulder muscles and for your neck muscles. This also is extremely good, right? You bring your shoulders forward like you're trying to touch these in space till it hurts a little bit. You go up to like a shrugging position, hold that for a moment, bring it all the way back, ooh, feel the stretch, and then release. So it's kind of like you're tracing a circle with a pencil that's coming out of your shoulder on the wall there. That's the kind of thing you want to do. And it's not like, you know, you're not jerking it around. It's nice, smooth, slow. All those types of exercises really go a long ways towards lubricating the joints, keeping the muscles toned, and a toned muscle is a relaxed muscle. Sometimes we get these problems because, you know, life is stressful, and sometimes we put stress into our muscles. And when that occurs, these muscles become tight. They become like, you know, in spasm. And that can scrunch the bones together and facilitate the formation of those bony spurs. So the way to keep those bony spurs away is to keep the muscles happy. And the way to keep the muscles happy is to use them with activity. And some muscles, like these muscles, they don't really get to do very much all day. Like when you're riding, you're using these, you're not really using these. So you want to make sure you use these, especially if these are a problem for you. And you use them by doing this or by doing the shoulder shrugs that we talked about. There's a whole host of exercises. Yes?
Does that shoulder exercise also affect the lower lumbar?
Yes, there's a whole bunch of very good exercises. So most of my patients that come to see me, I'll make sure that they get hooked up with a good physical therapist who will teach them exercises and empower them to do these exercises themselves. They don't have to keep going to the physical therapist. They just need a sort of a plan of things that they can do every day, a few little things, 10 minutes here, 10 minutes there, to kind of keep their bodies in shape and stay out of the doctor's office.
Right? Sheet of paper, on a sheet of paper.
On a sheet of paper, yeah. Yeah, so you don't forget them, right? They're like a little diagram. Now do this, this is how you do it, you hold it for this long, and even if it's not perfect, it's still, they're still really good. Yes?
all of us are coming to exercise classes here, I think.
Yeah.
Would it be possible that the physical therapist would give some lecture that you're doing to the trainers, or they already know how to take this subject?
That's a great question. I don't know who runs your exercise classes, but hopefully they have training. The goal is to gentle. There are two goals. One is to do, get a little cardiovascular exercise as far as you can tolerate, and then the other is to actually tone the muscles. Not build the muscles, just tone them. And I don't know who your person is and what kind of training they have. We work with physical therapists that we have at UCLA and we refer our patients there. I don't know whether they come to this kind of a venue. But a good physical therapist is worth their weight in gold because he or she can really give you good tips and good advice. And then they actually monitor you doing these things to make sure you're doing them properly. Oh, don't do it quite like that because that's going to hurt you. Do it like this because this will not hurt you, that kind of thing. And then make sure that you get a balanced number of exercises in your regular day. Yes.
You know, I get back pain like maybe every 6 weeks, 8 weeks, and I'll go to a chiropractor, and he'll put me back in shape. But then also I have the pain in the thighs, thighs and lateral.
Yeah.
So you said that's so related to the alpha.
It could. It all depends on your history, your physical exam findings, and so on. But getting back to the first point, some people like working with chiropractors. I have no issues with chiropractors, except that I generally advise all of my patients not to accept adjustments from a chiropractor, because that can, especially in the neck, it can hurt you. Every year at UCLA, we get about 10 strokes that result from accidental tearing of the arteries in the neck. We have four arteries, two in the front and two in the back, that happen when a very sudden adjustment is done. The body wasn't designed for such rough things, but if you have a chiropractor who you trust and who you've been going to for some time, wonderful. But I would generally stay away from adjustments because those adjustments may be a little bit rough, especially in our more senior years.
That's yes. Right. They don't do it. I have a chiropractor that I see, and they don't do adjustments anymore when you get to a certain age. So what could they do then?
What is the relationship in muscle pain and side effects of statin medication?
There are, some of you may be on statin medications for high cholesterol. Some of those have been shown to potentially have negative impacts on muscles. They can cause muscle weakness. And if you have any of your experiencing what you would not expect to have, which is sort of this sensation that your muscles just don't have any strength, it is important to mention that to your doctor so that he or she can check. If you're on a statin, check for the possibility that it could be related to one of your statin medications. They can switch you to a different one that doesn't cause that problem. But there are other things that can also cause weakness of the muscles, and then we need to check those things as well, like your calcium, your magnesium, and your potassium, to make sure that there's no issues with those, because those may also make you feel kind of weak and like the muscles don't have much strength. There are some rare conditions that can also cause muscle weakness, and those can be checked into if necessary. Yes.
Is there a blood test that tells you if you have enough magnesium?
Yeah.
How do I know if I'm short of magnesium?
Well, you just tell your doctor, your family doctor, am I short of magnesium? I wonder if I could be. And then they go, well, let's send you to the lab down the hall. We'll get a little quick, a little tiny blood test. It tells you right away what the magnesium is. And it's easy to supplement. But those deficiencies are not that uncommon. So sometimes it's worth, you don't have to check it all the time, but it's worth at least a one-time check. Because sometimes we have kidney issues that cause potassium wasting, or you may have other problems, like we may be on a bone strengthening medication. And that, if you're taking, for instance, a bone strengthening medication for osteoporosis, that can cause the calcium in your blood to get low, because the calcium is being gobbled up from the blood to be put into the bones. And that can leave you with kind of low calcium in your blood, and then you feel like a rag. So those are all things to mention to your doctor, and that's his or her job to check out those things and make sure that all those levels are spiffed up.
Susan, there's certain insurance companies like United Healthcare and SCAN, and seniors, they have programs, they call them silver sneakers. They are seniors, 65 or maybe 60 plus, and they have classes. I go to 20 hours with my physio, I mean, it's not standing on my head or anything, but it's yoga.
Yeah.
And we've got people in the class late 80s and early 90s.
That's wonderful.
Wednesday and Friday is stretching. It's great.
That's fantastic.
Depending on your insurance.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Yeah, so all of you can look into what your insurance coverage will cover, but there's more and more of an emphasis now on wellness and prevention. And that, I think, is really important because that keeps you out of the doctor's office. We should be the last people that you have to come and see unless it's your general practitioner, right? But we're there in case you need us. Okay, we're going to talk a little bit about this this facet joint. I told you that you have little miniature knee joints back here, one on each side going all the way up. And especially in the lower lumbar spine, these can develop arthritis. It's these guys right here. And they can be quite painful. Typically, that's a local pain that's quite sharp in the morning and gets a little bit better as the day goes on, and also a stiffness. That's typical of facets. And for those, we can put a little medication into those little pesky facet joints, too, and a little bit of steroid and anesthetic. And here's a diagram of a little tiny needle going into the joint. It doesn't need much, just a little touch of steroid and some anesthetic, both into the joint space itself and into the capsule around the joint, and that can be quite beneficial in relieving the pain that's coming from these arthritic joints. So the injections don't make the arthritis disappear, that is there, but they can significantly decrease the symptoms that result from the inflammation that's associated with the arthritis. And here's an example of a CT-guided facet injection. This is the patient's belly. They're on their stomach. This is the vertebra. These are the muscles around their back. And then this is the spinal canal. And then this is the joint space right here. You can see a little needle has gone right into the joint space and some medication is being delivered there.
Excuse me, so inflammation causes arthritis?
No, arthritis causes inflammation, which then causes pain. So here's an example. I do this procedure a fair amount. These are for people that have had facet blocks. They've got arthritis in their facets. We know that. They're arthritic. They've got terrible pain. And they get a facet block and it lasts 2 weeks. Wonderful relief. 2 weeks is all they get. We bring them back like the old boxer, do one more, 2 more weeks. So obviously we're on the right track, right? We've got the source of the problem, but we're not able to give them enough duration to make the procedure worthwhile. So for those patients, what we do is we put a little tiny needle right to where the little twig that comes back to the arthritic joint is located, and then we park that needle there. And rather than giving a little bit of steroid and medication there, we just heat up the tip of the needle and make a little cauterization, a little burn right where that nerve is, and burn that little piece of nerve. So that even though the arthritis is there, you can't feel it because there is no nerve coming from the arthritic joint up to the brain. So generally, these are very effective. These will last 6 months to a year and a half even. But what I do advise my patients is that when their pain goes down, they have to remember that their arthritis is still there because you don't want to over-irritate that nerve. Even if you're having no pain symptoms from it, you don't want to overwork that joint because eventually, over time, these little nerve twigs will regrow. And so the pain will gradually kind of come back after a year and a half, which we could repeat the procedure, but after repetitions, it tends not to be quite as effective. So generally, the best way to keep the pain away is to be mindful that the arthritis is there, even if you don't have the pain, and to take care of your low back so that you don't have that discomfort. And one of the most helpful things we can do for our facet joints, these little miniature knee joints that we have in the back, if you have low back pain, is to stand properly. Most of us tend to stand upright with a big curve back here. And what that does is it puts a lot of strain on those joints. So the way to relieve that is to separate your feet a little bit, bend your knees, and then let the pelvis fall forward. The minute you do that, it takes the stress off that low back. And at first you do it, this is really odd, Dr. Villablanca, what are you doing? But after a while you go, realize this is really quite comfortable. And you just make it a habit to when you stand, you're standing in line, you're standing watching something, you're reading whatever, you just got your knees bent a little bit, you've got your pelvis thrust forward, and it just relaxes the whole lower back. Very, very effective. So these are the advantages of that technique. It's called the radio frequency ablation because we're cooking those little tiny nerves and burning them. Sometimes people get problems in their spinal canal that's not a disc and it's not a bony spur. Here's somebody who has arthritis of their facet joints. Here you can see these facet joints. This is an image looking from underneath up at the spinal canal. This is the vertebra. This is the patient's belly button up here. This white stuff is the spinal fluid. These little black dots are the nerve roots floating in the fluid. And here you can see this big white blob. Does everybody see that big white blob? That's a synovial cyst. And because those facet joints are synovial lined joints, just like the knee, when the knee becomes inflamed, fluid gets built up in the knee, and the knee can swell up from this fluid. The same can happen in these little miniature facet joints. They can get these little synovial cysts, and if the synovial cyst goes into the canal, it can pinch the nerve. So here on the right side, see these two little dots? Those are two happy nerves floating in the fluid because they've got plenty of room. And on this side, where are the nerves? They're squished by this synovial cyst. So rather than going to the operating room to have that synovial cyst removed, me and my colleagues can put a little needle through the skin right into the cyst and aspirate or suck out the cyst contents and collapse it like a balloon. And that causes immediate relief of the pain that was coming from the nerve that was being squished.
Yes. So is it bad to have a cyst? Because I got a big one right here.
Well, this is a specific cyst. This is a synovial cyst arising from the facet joint. So this is normally a condition that would require you going to the operating room to have, you know, they would cut the skin here, cut the muscles, remove this bone, find the cyst, and cut out the cyst. Here, with just one needle, in a procedure that takes about 20 minutes, we aspirate the cyst, and the cyst is not gone, but it's flattened out like a balloon. And we typically, because we put a needle into it, it's like a leaky balloon. So it's hard for it to build back up again. So that can be another very effective technique.
So how do you know when you have a synovial cyst?
You get an MRI. So let's say you tell me, oh, you know, I've got terrible pain down my L4 distribution, blah, blah, blah. I say, I think it's a disc herniation. We get an MRI. Lo and behold, it's not a disc herniation. It's a synovial cyst. And if the synovial cyst has the right characteristics and geometry, I'll tell you, I think we can aspirate this cyst. Or I'll tell you, there are other special things about the cyst that I can't remove it. But that's what's good. This is information-based. We're not guessing. And whatever is done is specific to the problem. So it's not like this big, you know, gunshot approach, hey, let's numb up every nerve. No, we're just going to treat the one nerve that we think is the problem. Minimally invasive and minimal intervention. Sometimes we think it's the disc that's the problem, the cushion. And typically we'll do this procedure when somebody has multiple cushions that are diseased. And the patient has not responded to any conservative management, and now we think the patient may actually need a surgery. And the surgery that's most typically indicated here, if the cushion is completely injured, is to remove the cushion and then to let the two vertebrae come together and to have them fuse so that you now have a solid little bony block. And that typically requires a little bit of hardware, and that's done through our orthopedic or neurosurgery heart colleagues that help to stabilize that vertebra. But before doing that, before doing any procedure like that, we like to confirm that it is in fact the disc that we think it is that's responsible for the problem. And so one of the things that I will do and my colleagues will do is we'll put a little tiny needle into that disc space and put some numbing medicine in there. And if your pain goes away when the numbing medicine goes in, then that means that disc is the problem. If your pain does not go away, that means your pain is coming from someplace else and you don't need that surgery. So it's a good way to make sure that if you are going to have to undergo a surgical procedure, that you have it only if absolutely confirmed it's the right thing.
So can you repeat it? If the pain goes away, you need a surgery or you don't?
If the pain goes away, you probably need the surgery because that means that the disc was responsible for the pain, right? If the pain did not go away, that means, well, I put the disc to sleep. The surgeon thinks this is the problem. That disc is now asleep and your pain is still the same. That tells me it's not that disc that's the problem. We've got to look elsewhere, okay? If on the other hand, the pain goes completely away because I've numbed up all of that, that little belt, stuff inside, then you know, unfortunately it probably is that disc. All right, there's lots of ways for us to study these discs and determine how abnormal they are, and we have all kinds of fancy schmancy tests that we can do to help our surgeons understand the degree of degeneration and the degree of impairment. But again, the most important thing is not what the scan shows, but what the patient is experiencing, right? We do not treat scans. Lots of patients are walking around with horrible looking discs, but it doesn't bother them. So we're not going to treat that. We're only going to treat one that's really causing a problem. Sometimes it's not the disc, it's not the bone, it's not the nerve, it's actually a muscle. And there is this little muscle in your pelvis. This is a view of the pelvis from the back, looking through the butt muscles at this one little skinny muscle that's called the piriformis muscle. And the piriformis muscle is a muscle that's oriented kind of transversely. It goes from outside to inside across. It doesn't go up and down, it goes across. And this muscle helps the hip to internally rotate and to externally rotate. So you don't do that very often. So for that reason, this muscle is kind of a weak link. And sometimes people that are big runners will get themselves into trouble because when you run, your quads and your hamstrings get really strong, but your little piriformis is like a little weakling. So anytime you have a little weakling muscle surrounded by strong muscles, that weakling muscle is more vulnerable to injury. So you trip, you fall, you twist, and that little muscle can go into spasm. And because it's so deep and almost nobody knows anything about it, it can stay in spasm. And you can see what's right next to it, a yellow tube-like structure, which is the sciatic nerve. And this is somebody's sciatic nerve getting pinched by this piriformis muscle that's in spasm. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I've had that problem on the right side, but does it feel also like you have something wrong inside the hip socket itself?
It could. It could radiate to the hip. But typically, this manifests as buttock and leg pain that's unexplained by any problem in the lumbar spine. So when I have a patient that presents with that kind of a history, we've done the MRI of the lumbar spine, there's no herniation there, then I'll look for this problem in the pelvis. And if I find this problem, you can also test for it by doing special tests on the physical exam, and you can also press on the muscle. And if that area is tender, then you may have a piriformis muscle that's in spasm. And this can happen to anybody, young people and old people. I had a young 16-year-old woman who from Florida. She came all the way from Florida to see me because she was told by her doctors, orthopedic doctor, neurologist, emergency room doctor, pediatrician, that it was all in her head and she needed to go see a shrink. And I put one finger on her piriformis muscle and she almost jumped off the table. So I knew right away that this was her problem. And typically, you treat it first with muscle relaxants and with stretching exercises. And if that doesn't do the job, you can actually put a little tiny needle into the muscle and put the muscle to sleep. And generally, that does the job by relaxing the muscle. But in some people in whom this muscle has been really, really tight for a long time, you actually need to paralyze the muscle. And in her, I put a little bit of Botox in. And then the muscle was boop, totally relaxed, and her pain went away. Now, luckily, the muscle doesn't do too much, so it doesn't matter if the muscle is paralyzed. Usually, it's paralyzed for three to six weeks, and then it kind of comes back. But usually, by that time, it's behaving. So lots and lots of sort of clever little techniques that we have to figure out what's wrong and then to do the right test. So this is some testing for this piriformis syndrome, little things you can do on the physical exam to confirm that it is or is not possibly the piriformis syndrome that's the problem. And here's somebody undergoing an injection of that piriformis muscle. They're laying on their stomach. These are their intestines. These are their buttocks muscles. This is the fat in their butt cheeks. And then here's a fingertip pressing down on the skin and a little needle that's been put right into the muscle substance, and then this dark stuff is the anesthetic that's been administered into the muscle to give some symptomatic relief. And then I'm going to end with this condition. This is a pudendal neuralgia, which is groin and or perineal pain in women much more often than men. Yes.
After your previous
Yes.
Was that the same as trigger point injection
or less trigger? No, a trigger point injection really refers to feeling something with your finger that feels tender and then just putting a needle there and putting some medication. We don't do trigger point injections because they're blind, and so we don't really know where the medication's going and we don't know what it's injecting.
So that's not what you were describing for the piriformis?
No, this is actually doing a pressure test on the piriformis muscle, and because it's in spasm, it's tender. So when you put your finger on it or press into it, the patient says, oh my gosh, that hurts a lot right there, plus it's shooting down my leg. So this condition, fortunately, is not as common as the other conditions, but it is more common than any of us would like. It's a symptom of terrible pain around the front area or around the rectum area that's really aggravated by sitting, and sometimes relieved by standing or lying down. So some people, they sit down and they say, I can't sit anymore. I can only sit for 5 minutes. Otherwise, I get this terrible pain up here in the front in my femoral area. It can affect both men and women, but it's more common in women. And then when that happens, we suspect that they may have irritation of these little nerves, the pudendal nerves. And then when we suspect that that's happening, we will try all manner of non-invasive treatments, but sometimes what's necessary is to actually put some medication right where those little nerves live. And there's a patient who's laying on her stomach, and I have, after cleaning the skin and numbing it up, placed two tiny little needles right where those little nerves pass. And I'm delivering some anesthetic and a little bit of steroid right to where those nerves are to kind of soothe them and quiet them down so that these symptoms go away. And I, you talked about hip. This will be the last thing. Sometimes we get arthritis, not in our back, but actually in the hip joints back here. Right here, we can get arthritis here. These are the sacroiliac joints. And when that occurs and it doesn't respond to the usual Advil or Aleve, again, little tiny needles can be put into the joint space to decrease the inflammation. This does not cure the arthritis, but generally will give you some months of relief and reduce symptoms.
What do you call your
I am a neuroradiologist. Neuroradiologist, right. So a radiologist is anybody who looks at images, CAT scans, MRIs, and X-rays, and makes interpretations of those images. A neuroradiologist is somebody who does that, but only for brain and spine. And then for my group, which does pain management, we are interventional neuroradiologists, so that I see patients in clinic, we chat, we talk about the symptoms, we do a physical exam, we do the imaging if necessary, and then we also do any procedure that might be needed in case the patient doesn't respond to conservative management.
You have the neuro and the other thing.
Yeah, the musculoskeletal radiologist who deals with the joints. So we have thoracic radiologists. So most places, if you go out into the community, you have one radiologist doing everything. So one moment a radiologist will be doing a barium enema, then he or she will run over to the other room and interpret a mammogram. At UCLA and larger institutions, we subspecialize. So radiology is 4 years of training. Any subspecialty is 1 or 2 additional years of that, and this is in addition to the 4 years of medical school plus the 1 year of internship. So for me, I did 4 years of radiology training. That allowed me to become a radiologist. Then to become a neuroradiologist, you do an additional 2 years of training. Two more.
2 more years?
Yeah. Yeah. That's why I have all this gray hair. See, by the time I start practice, I'm almost ready to retire. Yes.
Are simple little things like heat and massage to any avail in helping pain?
Yes, oh absolutely. So for all the patients that I refer, the first line is conservative management. So physical therapy, exercise, massage, East-West Center referral, which we have at UCLA for acupuncture if you're interested in that. All of those things are far ahead of the line in the therapeutic course than any of these things. These are the things that are interventional that we do when somebody's not responding to those conservative treatments. Yeah.
Does Kaiser have a neuroradiologist?
Kaiser, some Kaisers do. I know that Kaiser Sunset has a couple of neuroradiologists.
Not West LA?
I don't know about Kaiser West LA. You'd have to check. Actually, they do. They have neuroradiologists, but there they only interpret films. They do not do procedures. So they just do the diagnostic part, they don't do the interventional.
Okay, the doctor does the diagnostic?
The radiologist, the neuroradiologist there would do the diagnostic. In other words, they would do the MRI or the CAT scan of the spine, but that's it.
And
they
wouldn't, follows up on that?
It would have to be up to one of your doctors. So what's special about UCLA is that we have a group that does the imaging, the clinic visit, and the procedure.
But you don't take Medicare.
Oh no, we do take Medicare. Yeah, as far as I know.
Were there plenty of ultra specialists you do?
So the question that was asked is if you're somebody who has had a surgical procedure and maybe you've improved a little bit, but now your symptoms have come back, you know, what's the best way to go? And the answer to that question really is surgery should be the last resort. Okay? You should have surgery when you can be no worse. Okay, that's when surgery should be done. And you need your doctor to help you in that decision process. But until that time comes, everything else should be tried before you consider surgery. That means you should try every conservative approach, all the injection things, all of that.
But you said it doesn't do anything to herniation.
No, it doesn't make the herniation go away, but it can buy time for your body to heal the herniation. So in some cases, the torn belt is so big that there's just no way to keep that jelly material in there. And it's just going to keep coming out. You know, if you just get up in the morning, more material will come out. In that case, you may in fact need the surgery. On the other hand, if you're getting some scar tissue there and things are beginning to heal, then you may be able to hang in there. And if the only symptom is pain, and the pain can be managed through medications, exercise, physical therapy, a lumbar support brace, etc., you may be okay. So it's very individual. Every case has to be managed individually. Yes?
How come you never mentioned nutrition and diet? It's so important about inflammation.
Well,
it has a lot to do with, but doctors ignore it.
No, I don't ignore it. The topic here was the management of the pain. Indirectly, diet is very important for pain, spine pain, because your weight plays a huge role in the amount of stress that your spine carries.
I'm talking about inflammation.
Yeah. Inflammation is a little less clear. So there are some diets that are thought to be pro-inflammatory, like a high-fat diet. But I like to be a little bit conservative until I'm actually sure that these things have been proven beyond a reasonable doubt. I prefer to just say it's an area that's being talked about and looked into, and maybe you have got some literature that I don't, but I don't know that I could say stay away from this food or definitely eat this food to minimize inflammation. Yes? Acupuncture is very good for relaxing muscles. So when we think that somebody's pain is primarily due to muscle spasm, then we'll have them consider acupuncture, massage therapy, and or a muscle relaxant. Sometimes they're used all together. Yes?
How many cc's of cortisone can you have in a year before it starts breaking down the bone?
It depends on the type of steroid that you use. For our group, we typically will do between 3 and 5 injections per year. If you're requiring more of those, they're probably not the right procedure for you. Some are long-acting, some are very short-acting, some are high-strength, some are low-strength, so it all depends. There's no amount. The amounts that we use are very small, so they're not the amounts that would be associated with weight gain or with osteoporosis. If you were taking oral steroids, you might be concerned about those types of things. But with just the little tiny doses that are given for these procedures, it's not really a concern. Okay. So nutrition is an excellent one, and unfortunately, I feel that we just don't have enough yet on it. It's a very important area, and you may have information from your doctors about specific diets that you should.
Not the doctor, but the television and
yeah.
Things like that.
Yeah, it's more in the lay press because they can afford to be a little bit more experimental. I like to be really certain about things that I advise my patients about, and I think there's not a ton of certainty right now about those things.
You don't know about gluten?
Gluten, no. That's probably the one that I'd be the most skeptical about.
Really?
Right now, gluten is thought to be responsible for everything under the sun. Poor gluten. Other questions? All right. Well, you guys have been a wonderful audience. Thank you so much.